Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Welcome to our worship service this morning. A special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area, looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. Let us begin with the order of confession and forgiveness. Ask that you turn to page 94 in the front of your worship book, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors and ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy on
us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so we can be like you live and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us now begin our worship with Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us, hymn number 789 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 789.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're happy to have you worship with us. This is our 10:30 service. The 19th day of July, 2015. Singing the first hymn, 789, which is Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us. Our theme today is Jesus is a Good Shepherd. This hymn was written by Dorothy Thrupp, Thrupp, and Dorothy lived 1779 to 1847. Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us, trust and guidance from Jesus the Good Shepherd.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Is reading the scripture. This is the eighth Sunday after Pentecost, July the 19th, 2015. Singing responsibly the 23rd Psalm, a very beloved Psalm, The Lord is My Shepherd.
Thank you.
spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Gospel acclamation. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. We'll be reading the Gospel, Jesus Christ, our Good Shepherd. Sing the Gospel acclamation with us, and notice that the pastor is standing in an elevated pulpit, and know that Jesus is there standing beside him. Baker is singing our special music, I'll Fly Away.
Oh,
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. There was a little first grader who was told to come home immediately after school. Each day, he arrived home later and later, to the point where he was over 20 minutes late. So his mother asked him, she said, "You get out of school the same time every day. Why is it it takes you so long to get home?" The little boy responded, "Well, Mom, it's because of the cars." His mother said, "What do cars have to do with your coming home from school?" He said, "Well, the patrol boy will not let us cross the street until cars come so that he can step out of the road and make them stop." The little patrol boy was impressed with his authority. He was impressed with the power that he had, and he intended to use it to the max. Why let the kids cross when there weren't any cars coming? Then he couldn't exercise his power. So make him wait until cars come, then I can step out and go stop, and all those cars have to stop at my command, and them children can cross. Power. It can be a wonderful thing, and it can be a disaster. It can be a great tool in leadership, or it can be a very negative tool in the hands of leadership. It doesn't matter whether you are a king, an emperor, a prime minister, or a president. It doesn't matter if you're a senator, a congressman, a governor, a state legislator, a mayor, a city council person, a county commissioner, or a county judge executive like we have back home in the Commonwealth of Kentucky. It doesn't matter if you're the chairperson of a committee, whether in some secular activity or in a congregation. When you are a leader, you have power. And it is important how you use that power. And God has given instructions on how power should be used. Some people will use power as it is intended in service to others. That is what power is all about. As we look through Holy Scripture, we see that God gave power for the purpose of serving others, not to be served. He did not grant power and authority so that people could indulge themselves, so that people could make themselves rich on the backs of the people they were serving. He did not give power to people so that they could settle old scores against people who they thought had did them wrong sometime in the past. When I graduated from my high school in Louisville in 1969, our high school principal was 1 year away from retirement. My class was the next to the last class he was going to supervise. He'd been at the school for over 30 years. He loved that high school. Well, a new superintendent during the summer was appointed as head of the Louisville school system. And his superintendent had a grudge against my principal for something way back when he had first started teaching and being a coach. And so one of his first actions were to demote my principal from that high school he loved to the worst high school in the Louisville school system. To a high school that nobody cared about. A high school that more than 3/4 of the kids didn't graduate. Maybe 2% went to college. With the high school I came from, not only did 97% of us go to college, but usually there were 2 or 3% of each graduating class that would make it to an Ivy League school. But this superintendent, having this power now, he settled old scores in his mind, demoted that principal. Of course, God has a way of having things work out. After a year of that superintendent's overseeing of the schools, the Louisville city school system went bankrupt. He lost his job, and the schools had to be overtaken by the Jefferson County school system. The power.
Some people love it. Some people do everything they can to obtain it. But with power comes responsibility. And when you do not use that responsibility correctly, there are dire consequences. In our first reading for today, from the 23rd chapter of the book of the prophet Jeremiah, this is exactly what we are dealing with. God, through the prophet Jeremiah, explaining his actions, explaining why the people of Judah are now in exile in Babylon, where they sit along on the banks of the rivers of Babylon, hanging their hearts in the trees, weeping and gnashing their teeth, and refusing to sing the songs of their old land, as they are prodded to do by their Babylonian captors. Jeremiah was a prophet for 30 years in the southern kingdom of Judah. During that 30 years, there were four kings in Judah, the last four kings of the southern kingdom. Of those four kings, two kings totally ignored Jeremiah, the word of the Lord that came through him. One king listened to him and then hedged his bets on whether or not he should follow completely what Jeremiah said, and one king listened to him. Because of that, because these leaders had power to serve the people and to serve God, and they didn't do it, the people are now in exile. The people are shattered. The people are disillusioned. The people are despondent and depressed. They are God's chosen. And yet their capital city of Jerusalem, the walls have been torn down, the temple has been destroyed, and the people carried off in exile. As we turn back to that 23rd chapter, the book of the prophet Jeremiah, the very first verse, God speaking through Jeremiah says, "Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering my sheep." This is God's warning to any leader, secular or spiritual. This is his warning to any leader, no matter how high of a position you have or how little the position you have. You are not to destroy and scatter the sheep. When God uses the word shepherds, he's talking about every leader from king, emperor, Caesar, president, down to the lowest government official. They all have power. They all have responsibility to serve. But the kings of Judah did not do that. The kings of Judah, three of them, the last three, paid no mind to what Jeremiah said and what God said. They thought they could rule any way they wanted to. And so God indicts them for their behavior, because it wasn't just the kings, it filtered down to every other official. You see the same thing during Jesus' lifetime, during his public ministry. Not so much in the secular realm, but in the spiritual. The Pharisees had made Judaism such a burden. They had piled on so many rules and regulations that the fishermen and the shepherds and the tanners and the masons and the farmers could not fulfill all those rules and regulations. And so they felt depressed and despondent. They felt like they were in utter defeat because there was no way they could do all that was demanded. And so, in the religious realm, we can have the same abuse of power. In the religious realm, we can have religious leaders who abuse that power as well. And instead of using it to serve God's people and his kingdom, they use it for their own material gain and popularity. Woe to you, shepherds, who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture. That word destroy means to perish, cause to perish. Or it means for one to have utter defeat. Of course, carried the people off in exile, as I said, so they were utterly defeated. The glory days of David and Solomon were long gone, long in the past. Now they were suffering. Now you might say, well, why was it fair to make them suffer when it was the leader's fault? Well, the problem was the people went along with the leaders. When the leaders refused to listen to God, the people refused to listen to God. They thought as long as the temple stood in Jerusalem, they didn't have a thing to worry about. As long as they had fulfilled their obligations of going up on the holy days and making their sacrifices in the temple, then all would be okay. Jeremiah rebuked them, saying, you claim the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. But that building will not save you from the wrath of God, which is to come. And so as leaders have that responsibility, a mark of good leadership is that you use your power in a positive way to serve the people. The people being ruled also have a responsibility to make sure that their leaders are obeying God's word and God's will. The word scatter. It's a Hebrew word that literally describes taking a vase or some other object and throwing it on the ground so that it dashes into pieces. When I was a kid living on my grandma's farm, my one cousin was kind of like an older brother to me. He was born in August of 50 and I was born in February of 51, so he was always ahead of me in school, but we were only about 6 months apart. He'd come out to the farm and he'd go through the trash and find light bulbs, because we like to take those light bulbs and throw them against the side of the barn and watch them shatter. Well, that's what Jeremiah's describing. Through false leadership, through leadership that uses power only for its own advantage, the people become scattered like a broken vase, or broken pottery, or a broken light bulb. The word means to disperse. It calls people to be disjointed. Today, we would translate that as leaders who, instead of uniting people together, use class warfare, or racial warfare, or ethnic warfare, or educational warfare, or some other kind of thing to keep people apart, to cause people to have friction with one another because they're different from each other. That would be how you smash the people to pieces today. We don't have to go off into exile. We have enough problem living together. The idea of the melting pot. It seems like the melting pot got overturned. As people today, because of politicians, think more of who they are, their ethnicity or their racial makeup or their educational or their financial, economic, whatever, that they seem to think that's more important than the fact that from many comes one. In the religious realm, churches today have the problem of preachers not preaching the word of God, but preaching what they think or what they feel, which is just a way for them to wrap up their own political agenda, but try to push it off as God's word. So when preachers do not preach the word of God, but preach only what people want to hear, what they think, what they feel, then the church becomes separated. The church becomes scattered, and the church becomes dispersed because there's no unity now as people fight with one another over is this really what the church is about or not. Whereas if we stay true to God's word, we know what the purpose of the church is. First, to proclaim the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. To preach good news to our hurting world so that they may find that the way to salvation is not through a heavy burden, not through sacrifice, not through works righteousness, but that salvation is by faith in Jesus Christ. Faith in Jesus Christ, suffering and death upon the cross, that he willingly took our place upon that cross, paid the debt of sin that we owe. That on that third day he rose again, 40 days later ascended into heaven, and he will come again in glory. Those last verses of our reading today, There'll be justice, there'll be mercy, there'll be righteousness, and he will rule us. Not like the kings in the final years of Judah, like those politicians or those rulers that rule only for themselves. So the church must listen to Jeremiah every bit as much as the ruler. Because in the church, we could cause the sheep to be scattered. And what we learn from Jeremiah today, God speaking to Jeremiah, is that God will not take this lightly. That God will not take abusing the power he has granted lightly. He says, therefore, thus says the Lord God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who are tending my people, you have scattered my flock and driven them away, and have not attended to them. Behold, I'm about to attend to you for the evil of your deeds, declares the Lord. You have not attended to my flock. That, here the word attended means to pasture, to care for. A shepherd in the ancient world in the Middle East came attached to the sheep that they watched for. They protected them and looked out for them and cared for them and comforted them and sought the lost sheep. But when he then says, I'm about to attend to you, here the word means to punish or to chastise. The kings of Judah were chastised and punished. Those rulers in history who have been extremely abusive with the power they were granted, we have seen how they have been punished in the pages of history. We have seen, even in the life of the church, those who abused the power suffer chastisement and punishment. So God says the mark of a leader is that they use that power for justice, they use that power for mercy, they use that power for righteousness, they use that power to care for the widow, the stranger, the orphan in our midst. They use that power to be concerned about the hungry, to be concerned about the oppressed, to be concerned about the persecuted, to be concerned about those who are marginalized, to be concerned about those who are economically challenged, to care for those who are distressed. That is a responsibility of leaders, no matter secular or religious. It is the number one, after preaching the good news of the gospel, is the number one concern of the church. Care for the hungry, the widow, the orphan, the stranger, the marginalized, the persecuted, the oppressed. To be their champion. So then God says to Jeremiah, I will raise up shepherds over them, and they will tend them. That word tend means to pasture a flock. That's the imagery of a shepherd who goes and leads his sheep to a beautiful pasture full of plentiful grass, where there is shade for them to rest in during the heat of the day, where there is plenty of cool, clean water for them to drink, where the shepherd is at an advantage where he can protect his sheep from the bear, the wolf, the lion, or the thief. The shepherd serves the sheep. And leaders are to serve their people. Whether they are secular or religious, they are to serve the people. They are to use that power for the benefit of all people, not for the benefit of themselves. How often do we hear stories in our nation about someone being elected to the House of Representatives, or being elected to the Senate, or even elected president? And they go into that office as middle class, and after several terms, they're suddenly a multimillionaire. Are they serving the people, or are they serving themselves? Prophet Jeremiah, we hear that God will not tolerate such abuse. That it is a responsibility, the mark of leadership, to serve. And and that is the mark of the church, to serve. To serve humanity so that they may come to the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that they may hear the preaching of the forgiveness of sins and salvation through the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. In this congregation, with the power we have been given through the Holy Spirit, we use our gifts and our time and our talent and our energies to feed the poor, to clothe the naked, to visit the prison. And so do not let a leader ever tell you that their power means they can do whatever they want. I don't care if, as I said, if it's the chairman of a committee, the president of the PTA, the president of the school band, or the school athletic department. Doesn't matter if it is the town clerk, the dog catcher, or whomever. If you're a leader, your responsibility is to serve. The power you've been given is not for your benefit and your glory, but it is to serve those who are in need. So that is the mark of a leader. Using power to serve. Not being like the patrol boy who made the children wait for cars so he could exercise his power over the traffic. It is to be like our Lord Jesus Christ, who willingly served all humanity and always had compassion for those sheep who had no shepherd. Amen. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. I didn't bring my bulletin with me, so we will sing whatever. 778. And number 778.
Singing hymn number 778, The Lord's My Shepherd. This is taken from the Scottish Psalter, 1650. The Psalter is the Psalms, and this is the 23rd Psalm, and set to music by Jessie Irvin. Jessie Irvin was the daughter of a parish priest, and her town in Scotland was Crimond, Scotland, and the clocks were wrong. It had 24 minutes longer for each day, and she said that we could sing The Lord's My Shepherd 24 minutes longer because the clockmaker made a mistake. This is 1650, Lord's My Shepherd.
Thank you.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father and the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Growing in the soil of the Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who seek the richness of life in God. Our response to the phrase, gracious God, is, hear our prayer. Shepherd your people, O God, with faithful pastors and teachers who listen to your voice and proclaim your word with truth and integrity. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Break down the walls of hostility between the nations, O God, and bring peaceful resolution to war-torn regions of the world. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Gather those who are homeless and destitute, sick and powerless, into your embrace of mercy, O God, that they may be restored to wholeness. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Enable the members of this parish to hear your inviting call to rest this summer season. Give us times of refreshment in the midst of the rigorous demands of schedules and responsibilities. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Enfold those who are dying in your eternal arms of mercy, and comfort those who mourn with a vision of all your saints, forever joined in our heavenly home. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Hear us as we pray, living God, and in your mercy give us all good things, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Time for our offering. Our ushers are John Dietrich and Karen Dietrich. This is the eighth Sunday after Pentecost, the birthday of the church. It's the 19th day of July, 2015. We again invite you to come on this coming Friday to the Gotha Bell Choir from Germany. They've been a very, very old bell choir from Lutheran area, and you'll enjoy the service. Everybody is welcome. 7 o'clock. Be the bell choir from Gotha, Germany. It'll be a free will offering to help defray their expenses. You'll love hearing them. You'll be inspired. Today we're worshiping Jesus Christ, our Son, the Son of God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We're receiving Holy Communion. You can read in Gospel of John, 6th chapter, that Jesus said that if you receive his body and blood, you receive eternal life. We love God, we love one another, we repent, we believe, and we receive the real body and real blood as we are united with Jesus Christ, our brother, and we become children of God. We invite you to come worship with us. This is our 10:30 service. You're watching it on YouTube. You can come at 8 o'clock, drive-in service. Next Sunday is Christmas in July. We ask you to bring your canned goods to feed the poor. We are very aware of poor in our midst. We want to help them as God has asked us on every page of the Bible. He has told us not to judge one another, but to love one another. and to feed the poor, to help one another. Flowers today are given by Pam Riggs, to the glory of God. We always have fresh flowers on our altar, beautiful flowers, and they're taken to the sick after the church service.
Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather in this table. In our communion age and own individual congregations, we invite and encourage to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of our Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 107 in the front of your worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
And the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let me see. Christ given for you. Body of 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 Christ given for you. By the name of Jesus, I pray that bless us such a child to be in the care of our Father. By the name of Jesus, I pray that bless us such a child to be in the care of our Father. Body of Christ given for you. 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 Body of our Lord Jesus Christ, whose precious blood sprinkled and preserved you in true faith, unto life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
He wrote many of his hymns when he was only in his 20s. He was a brilliant young man. He learned Latin and Greek and Hebrew when he was only 4 years old. He wrote these hymns, the father of English hymnology, and he wrote hymns because he wasn't satisfied with the Psalter. He wasn't satisfied with the hymns that were taken from the Psalms. He said he could do better, and he did write beautiful hymns, thousands of hymns. This is one of his hymns. His most famous hymn is probably We're Marching to Zion, but this hymn is today in honor of the Lord is my shepherd, Isaac Watts, father of English hymnology.
Thank you.
to our organist, Greg Nolte, playing our beautiful church organ. We invite you to come, listen to our service, participate in our service in person. We'd like to have you here. We love you. We need you. We're involved with people in our neighborhood trying to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, all the things that God tells us to do. We're trying to do. We invite you to come help us. Worship God, love your neighbor, repent, believe. We thank you for watching St. John's on YouTube. We invite you to share this ministry with others. Take your computer to shut-ins, take your computer or your iPad to those around you and play the service. Witness in this way. Love God, love your neighbor, repent, believe. Obtain eternal life. Take God into your person through the Holy Communion. We serve Holy Communion every week on Wednesday at 6:30 in our chapel service, and every other Sunday at our, usually our 10:30 service, sometimes at the drive-in service. Take Holy Communion, receive the true body and true blood of Jesus Christ. He died for our sins. He does not leave us orphans. He's with us forever. We are united with Him to love God, serve one another, and to obtain the joy of His salvation. Tune in next Sunday and any Sunday and any time. We're happy to bring you this service. We offer a Christian school. If you have any children, grandchildren, you need a Christian education, call our office. Age 3-4, nursery and pre-K. We have daycare, but not in the summer. We have daycare starting in September. And thank you for joining us in our worship this Lord's Day. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you and keep you this day and all your days. We'll pray for you, and you pray for us. We'll love God, and we'll walk in the ways of Jesus Christ, walk in the wonders of His love.